we witnessed yesterday, the one of our soldiers crossing over. So we have to do something down here because we want.
Bow our heads in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, come to you as humbly as we know how, Heavenly Father. Heavenly Father, thanking you for the blessings that you bestowed upon us, Heavenly Father. Yes. Heavenly Father, come ask you to bless each and every one on the sound of my voice,
yes, sir. Yes.
Heavenly Father. Heavenly Father, bless those who are here and those who are on their way, Heavenly Father. Heavenly Father, we ask you to bless the sick and afflicted within our church, Heavenly Father. Bless them, Heavenly Father. Bless them with more strength, Heavenly Father. Bless them with an understanding that God will take care of them.
Yes, yes.
Heavenly Father, we ask you to bless those who are distraught, Heavenly Father, financially or any other way, Heavenly Father. Build them up where they're torn down, Heavenly Father. Strengthen them where they're weak, Heavenly Father. Heavenly Father, we ask you to go with our pastor this morning, Heavenly Father. Bless him, Heavenly Father, that he might preach an uncompromising gospel. Heavenly Father, we ask you to bless each and every auxiliary within our church, Heavenly Father. We ask you to strengthen us as a congregation, Heavenly Father. Heavenly Father, we are praying for the love, Heavenly Father, that we all might be on one accord, Heavenly Father. Heavenly Father, we ask you for your mercy and your grace, Heavenly Father, that we might go out in this world, Heavenly Father, telling someone about Jesus, telling someone about who they can come to be blessed, Heavenly Father. Telling someone about who they can come to give their life to, Heavenly Father. Heavenly Father, we ask you to bless us within this church, Heavenly Father. Heavenly Father, we ask these blessings and many more in the darling Son Jesus' name. Let the church say,
amen. Blessed, highly favored,
amen.
Exceedingly and abundantly blessed,
all right.
Exceptionally blessed,
all right.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
I feel good this morning.
Amen. All right.
I feel totally blessed.
Mm-hmm.
After yesterday's homeboy for Sister Johnson.
All right.
Amen.
And then after the accident with Sister Henderson. God is good. And all the time.
God is good.
You don't know how bad things could be.
That's right.
Amen.
A lot of times we say God won't put any more on us than we can bear, but that ain't necessarily true. He ain't gonna put no more on us than he can pull us through.
That's right.
You don't know your limitations until God puts it on you.
Yes, yes.
And a lot of times we get stressed and stressed out, but nevertheless, God's in control.
Mm-hmm.
Something that comes to mind is your mindset. And why do I say your mindset? Because oftentimes Satan is attacking your mind.
Amen.
If he can get your mindset, he's got you.
Yes, he does.
He can cause you to stress about finances. If he can cause you to stress about your children. If he can cause you to stress about your job, he's got you, because then he's taking your mind off of God.
All right.
The Bible says, trust him for one thing, trust him for all.
Amen.
And if you trust in him, then why are you worried?
Amen.
Think about what you're thinking about. When Peter stepped out of the boat onto the water, he was focused on Christ. He wasn't focused on drowning. What are you focused on? Where's your mindset at?
Am I?
Is Satan taking the small things and causing you to be upset? Where's your mindset at?
All right.
Are you trusting him? Are you looking to the hills from which cometh your help?
All right.
Because I don't know about you, but all my help comes from the Lord.
Amen. Amen.
And we're going to worship him this morning.
All right.
Like he so righteously deserves. We ain't going to let Satan in the house. We don't want him here. Kick him out.
Amen.
Put him out, whatever you got to do with it. But we not, We not give them any energy, any time, and any praise. Because he don't deserve it. But we're going to worship God this morning. Can I get an amen this morning?
Amen.
Okay, I got a few people. I said, can I get an amen this morning?
Amen.
That's right. We're going to worship him like we want to be blessed.
Amen.
If you would join me this morning for a moment, we're going to pray and invite him in a little bit more, and then we're going to turn up. Let him show up and show out.
Amen.
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 Let us pray. Our Father in heaven, we come to you this morning, Savior. Realizing and recognizing that you are God.
Mm-hmm.
And that beside you there is none other.
Yes.
Father, realize that I can trust you for one thing and I can trust you for all. And I come leaning and depending on you, Savior.
Mm-hmm.
Father, as I stop and I think about all you've done for me. Father, I stand corrected, all the things you've done for me, but some of them I can't even remember, Lord.
Okay.
I say thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Lord.
All the time Satan has tried to derail me and throw me off task.
Oh, yes. Mm-hmm.
But Lord, you continue to prop me up when he tried to knock me down.
Okay.
You built me up where he was tearing me down, Savior.
All right.
When I was stressed, you sent your comforting spirit. When I was worried, Heavenly Father, you showed me that there was no need to be worried, that you had all power in your hands, Savior.
Yeah.
And for that, I say thank you, Jesus. You've been good to me.
Yeah.
Better to me than I've been to myself, Lord.
Yeah.
See me through danger, seen and unseen, Lord.
Yeah.
I don't know what I would do without you. Every time I turn around, you're blessing me. Even when I don't deserve it. You allow me to wake up this morning and see a day that I've never seen before and will never see again. Food on my table and clothes on my back, Lord. A reasonable portion of health and strength, Savior. Thank you again, Lord, because without you I can do nothing, but through you all things are possible. Father, I ask you for a special blessing on Sister Johnson's family.
Yes.
If they ever needed you, they need you right now, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
We all have suffered the loss of a loved one, Lord, but that's nothing like losing your mother. For your wife. The emotions run deep.
Oh, yes.
The tears flow. But Father, we realize that there's no tear that you can't take care of, Savior. Bless her son and her husband, the rest of her family.
All right.
With whatever it is that you see they stand in need of.
Yes.
Link them together like a strong chain.
Yes.
Love even stronger than it's ever been before, Savior.
Right.
Father, bless everyone that sets under the sound of my voice and knows that are yet on the way. For we all struggle with something, Savior. Granted, Heavenly Father, show us what it is that we need to do, Lord.
All right.
And I'm reminded of Pastor Sullivan going there and the words he told me as a young man to make that first step that you would help to make that second one, Lord. Words of wisdom, Savior, that he parted upon me. Father, come within these four walls. Allow your spirit to run from heart to heart and breast to breast. Help us to recognize how blessed we are, Savior. To say amen to the truth, to pet our feet, to clap our hands, to sing along, to pray the prayer of the righteous, Heavenly Father.
Yeah.
Bless our pastor this morning, help him to preach an uncompromising gospel. Give him the words that he needs, Heavenly Father.
Yeah.
And we'll be careful to give you the praise, the glory, and the honor, Lord.
Yeah.
Because you deserve it all, Heavenly Father. Help us to recognize what it is that our mindset is focused on. Help us to see Satan as he tries to attack us, Heavenly Father.
Yes.
Father, I'm reminded of the biblical story of the thorn being in his side, Heavenly Father. Lord, realize that Satan is sticking us with thorns, Heavenly Father. Mm-hmm. But that's all right. You said your grace was sufficient, Heavenly Father.
Yes.
When we claim the victory in your name, Jesus.
Yes.
In your name, Savior.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Till I come to church. But the devil is a liar.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. I'm out there hollering and joking, and I'm clear throated.
Yes.
When I get here, it wants to get raspy, turn. But I'm grateful to be here on this another Lord's Day. We're going to move on in the service portion of the choir that is here, and we're going to receive them in the traditional way. Amen. And I ask all of you to rise as the choir procession in. Amen. The Lord is in his holy place.
Yes,
we are in this place to worship him in the spirit of holiness. Amen. So let us come into his presence with singing and into his court with praise.
Yes.
Come on.
Yes.
Good.
I've lived in plenty. I've lived in want. I've been through a storm. But I will bless the Lord at all times. Because even in the midst of my trial and tribulation, He's good. God is good, children, all the time. And all the time, God is good. Yeah. Speaking of the goodness of the Lord, for our scripture lesson this morning, let me invite your attention to Romans, the 8th chapter, beginning at verse number 28, and we're going to read until the Lord says, stop. Romans 8, 28, very familiar passage of scripture to those of us who are in the household of the faith. Now, when you have it, say amen.
Amen.
Don't have it, say wait a minute. All right, I'm waiting. 60 seconds. Only a minute. But eternity is wrapped up in it.
Amen.
Yeah.
Wrapped. Yeah. 8 and 28.
Romans 8 and 28, yes.
Amen.
I'm reading from the King James Version of the Bible. And you'll find these words recorded. The Apostle Paul, writing to the Church of Rome, penned these words. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are called according to His purpose, for whom He did foreknow, He did predestinate to be conformed to the image of His Son, that He might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, whom He did predestinate, them He also called. And whom He called, them He also justified. And whom He justified, them He also glorified. What shall we then say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? He that spared not His own Son, but delivered Him up for us all, how shall He not with Him also freely give us all things? Who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? It is God that justifies. Who is he that condemneth? It is Christ that died, yea, rather, that is risen again, who is even at the right hand of God, who also maketh intercession for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or perils or sword, as it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long, we are counted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all these things we are more than conquerors through Him that loves us. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height or depth or any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Let the church say amen. It doesn't matter.
Amen.
What you're dealing with.
Yes, sir.
The word says it shall not separate you
from the love of God.
From the love of God.
Yes. That's right. Yes.
Glory, hallelujah.
Amen.
Praise to the Lamb. For He's worthy
to be praised.
Amen.
Yes, sir. Amen. 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 Come on, Jim.
Yeah. We're here for a reason, and Jesus is the reason.
Yes, he is.
We're here to worship the Lord in spirit and in truth. choir's going to come and going to sing and move on up the King's Highway. And then I'm going to invite your attention to a passage of scripture found in the book of Acts. Amen. So we're here to worship the Lord today. It shan't be long if the Lord say so. Stumbling blocks in our path when we're trying to serve the Lord. Anybody here witness to that? Amen. When you're trying to live right, give right, act right, serve right, Satan will always throw something up to try to discourage you. But if you want the Lord to really bless you and strengthen you, then you've got to do something.
Amen.
You and I have to turn from our wicked ways. And if we can do that, then God is able to use us to His glory and His honor. And I don't know about you, but I want God to use me till He use me. Come on, boy.
It was God that was calling.
to do his part, you've got to do your part.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Yes. Amen. Yeah, nothing from nothing, leave nothing. You don't put nothing in, you can't get nothing out.
Amen.
Amen. In order for us to be the people that God's calling for us to be, we've got to make a change in our lives. We have to turn from our wicked ways.
Yes.
Amen. I know, I don't know about you, but I want the Lord to be with us. Amen, all the time. Amen. The Bible says his name is Emmanuel. Emmanuel meaning God with us. Amen. Amen. Meaning God with us.
Amen.
But I see, Brother Taylor, I don't know what you have on your mind, but come on, play with the Lord, laid on your heart this morning. Amen. Let's leave Emmanuel off today. But I want you to know, if you want God to be with you, you have to invite him to come in. Amen. What I love about my God, he's an all-powerful, almighty God. He's omnipotent, he has all power, but he won't force his way into your life or on you. You have to invite him in.
Yes.
Amen. Yeah, you have to invite him in. If you invite the Lord to come in, he'll show up.
Yes.
He'll show out.
Yes.
Amen. How many of you are going through right now?
Amen.
Amen. Yeah. Yeah, yeah, going through, got a problem?
Amen.
Uh-huh. We sang it on the way out. If you were at the home going to Sister Johnson, we're going to sing it this morning, and then we're going to get on up out of here. All right? Come on, Brother Taylor. Let's go. We're going to sing our theme song. I don't know about you. Sometimes I don't understand. I said, Lord, I'm trying to do the best I can.
Yes, yes.
Lord, and people don't understand. They always seem to be fighting and all this confusion going on. When you try to do right, seem like every step you take forward, you have to take two or three back. You try to serve God and look like trouble come on every hand. You don't understand it now. Well, don't worry about it. Just keep serving God. Don't panic. Don't fall out. Don't quit. Just hold on. Because why? Because you'll understand it better by and by when you see God face to face. And so glad, Lord, and when this life is over, we'll see him if we hold on and hold out. But until then, my brothers and sisters, let's keep on holding on to God's unchanging hand.
Come on, fellowship, love, life, sunshine. In that
morning. And I did what I always do. I had a little talk with Jesus. I told him all about my trouble. He heard my faintest cry. And he answered by and by. He brought me out to the house of worship one more time. Before we any farther go, we want you to bring your attention as God's brought it back to my remembrance. We noticed that Sister Mary Henderson isn't here, mother in waiting. Isn't here. And she's at home convalescing. Yesterday, after the homegoing celebration, Sister Johnson, after the repast, had been served the thing. She was on her way home and had an automobile accident.
Amen.
All right, now, what's the baby's name?
Tamira.
When a car and a gentleman ran a red light and hit him, he did a 360 down at 22nd and Garland, and she ran into a pole and damaged the car, but she and her granddaughter, well, the bumps and bruises were all right. They were checked out and they're home right now. As a matter of fact, it was a three-car accident and none of the participants was seriously injured. And that is a blessing in and of itself.
Amen.
Amen. They were checked out at the emergency room out at Baptist East last night. I wondered why she waited. She said, Elder, Pastor Elder, I had to wait because if we go to the emergency room out here, these folks won't get us in and get us out and go downtown. They're down there, you're down there forever. If it's not an emergency, you're going to wait. And so she's doing fine, as well as can be expected. Cars can be replaced. Cars can be repaired. But life goes on, so we're grateful that there were no serious injuries. So keep her in your prayers. They heard her family. She had a spiritual family that was behind her. I think this Brother Tim, Sister Chambers, and them were behind her as she was going down. So she had people right there immediately that were there. And her sons were called, and those young men showed up, and everything was all right. So we're keeping her. Deacon, you talk to her? Deacon Harris, you talk to her? You talk to Mother?
I talked to her
last night. You talk to her, Sister Jackson?
This morning?
Yeah.
She said she could go fast, she
could go slow. Yeah. Good. So we never know, brothers and sisters, where we'll be, what we'll be doing when accidents. And the guy asked the guy, I said, what happened? And he said, I just ran a red light. He said, many times I've come down this way, I ran a red light. And it's an accident. It was an accident. I asked him how he was doing. He said, well, thank you for asking, because you know the center of attention. Of course, his mother, and after I made sure mother was all right, I'm going to check the others, and he just simply ran around. Like, you never know when an accident's going to happen. That's why they're called accidents. So we be prepared, just like we never know when death is going to overtake us. So it behooves us to be prepared. From the Gospel according to Acts, let's go see if I can get you out in due time. I know you want to spend this beautiful Sunday doing what you can do, because it's going to rain Monday. While you're turning to the book of Acts, amen. Chapter number 11, Acts 11, verse number 26.
Amen.
Chapter 11, verse number 26, you'll find these words recorded. The Apostle Paul writes these words. And when he found him, let me back up to 25. It says, then departed Barnabas to Tarsus for to see Saul. That's Paul. And when he found him, he brought him into Antioch. And it came to pass that a whole year they assembled themselves with the church and taught much people. And the disciples were first called Christians, first
in Antioch. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord.
Amen.
Then departed Barnabas to Tarshish to seek Saul. And when he found him, he brought him into Antioch. And it came to pass that a whole year they assembled themselves with the church and taught much people, and the disciples were called Christians first in Antioch. I find it very interesting when we study this passage of scripture to note that the disciples were not called Christians right after Christ died. It's interesting to note that they didn't call themselves Christians. They were called brethren, or disciples, or men of the way. And it was the Antiochians, the people in Antioch, who gave men and women who followed Jesus the name Christians, as far as we know. This is the very first time they were called Christians. Isn't it interesting that the people in Antioch decided to call them Christians? They didn't call themselves Christians. They were brethren, people of the way, followers of Jesus. But the Antiochians, the people in this seacoast city, this city where Paul and them had been preaching and teaching for over a year, Jesus Christ, a dead, buried, and resurrected Savior, it's here that the people decided to call them Christians. And we oftentimes call ourselves Christian, but they didn't call themselves Christian. The people in the city where they lived, where they worked, called them Christian. And as far as we know, this was the first time. And it brings to my mind, I wonder, why were they called Christians? If I can use my sanctified imagination for a few minutes, I like to think that they were called, that there was something about their character, the way they carried themselves, that made the Antiochians want to call them Christians. It was something about their character, something about their conduct, something about the way they live, something about how they believe that reminded others of Jesus. They weren't given the name as a compliment, brothers and sisters, but they were given this name to ridicule them, to make fun, to make mockery of them. They were called Christians. But what was it about them in the city of Antioch that made them stand out so much that the Antiochians, the people who were living a life of sin, would call them Christians? And so it is to bring the question today, to my mind, what are people calling us who attend church every Sunday? What are they saying about us behind our backs? How do they describe us? Do they call us Christians? Huh? They call us Christians, but are we acting like Christians? It wasn't a compliment. They did it to ridicule them, to make fun of them, but that was the greatest compliment that a city full of sinners could have paid to the followers of Jesus Christ. Because in order for them to be called Christian, there had to be something about the way they were living that identified with what they were teaching and preaching. Why? Because the people called them Christian. They were teaching Jesus Christ to live like Christ, to live for Christ. And so evidently, there was enough of their character that led people to say, you know, they're Christians. They're Christ-like. It's different. And then as people were converted in that city, people they knew on their block, on their jobs, in their schools, were converted and took on a Christ-like character and persona, it led the people to see a difference in their buddies, your drugging buddies, your partying buddies, when you give your life to Christ, when you're trying to live for Jesus, they see a difference in the way you walk. Y'all for quiet standing me. A difference in the way you talk, the subject of your conversation, and the way you allow yourself. You don't sit around and let they said, man, there's something different about you. Or they say behind your back, you know, Terry didn't got stuck up. Mm. He thinks he's better than we are. He acts funny now when you're talking about such and such and such and this and that. You know, he ain't no fun no more. It's something different. And it's not that Christians can't have fun, but it's the kind of fun you have. As a Christian. And so it is, my brothers and sisters. I asked myself many days. I told y'all a story, and I'll tell you that I was working at Builder's Metal. I was at church, like some of y'all. I was at church. Mm-hmm. Every Sunday I was at church. Mm-hmm. I'm going somewhere, stick with me. I was at church, but I was working on a job. An old boy named Blue, Stephen McClure, he's dead now. I preached his funeral and his brother's funeral. We grew up together. And Blue and I, when we get our checks, we go down to Ziegler Drugstore, get your check cash, and then if you get your check cash, you buy a little nip. And they wouldn't buy the little nip, they would take a little nip. Hey, snap, I'm at church now, I'm telling you, I'm at church. I take a little nip, and take a little nip, and go back to the job, and I'm at church. And Blue could sing pretty good. I said, Blue, man, you ought to come to church and get in the choir. And I used to say that to him. We were working, and I guess one day Blue had enough nip in him, more nip than I had. And Blue told me to my face, he called me Snap. He said, Snap, man, if you going to heaven, I'm going to heaven too. You doing the same thing I'm doing. Y'all know I had an answer for him.
Amen.
The answer was I hung my head in shame and walked away. I couldn't tell this man nothing about Jesus.
Yeah.
Y'all feel me?
Amen. Amen. Amen.
See, because I was at church.
Well.
But I wasn't in church.
Yeah.
Well, I don't know, some of you don't want to hear this, but it's true anyhow.
Yeah.
And that's the problem with our communities, our world, and our homes today, is that we have folk at church.
Yeah.
Yes.
But not in church. Because if you're in church, church is in you.
Yes.
This building is just a place we assemble. The church of God is in us.
Yes, yes, yes.
The regenerated, baptized believers in Jesus Christ.
Yes, yes.
Oh, glory. So it was in Antioch. For a year, they labored there, and the people saw a difference. Baby, there ought to be a difference in you. If you've been around church, there ought to be some change in your life. Yeah, folk ought to be able to look at you and see a difference. Yeah. You know what old saying said, I looked at my hands.
Yeah.
My hands look new. Looked at my feet, and they did too.
Yeah.
See, people on the outside see the same hand, but you understand your hand that you used to roll with.
Yes.
Oh, y'all got the machine to roll it. Y'all got the thing now. You just put the paper in, wet it, and come out. Some of y'all are laughing. Y'all know what I'm talking about. Ready to roll. You understand? Hand that you used to go and were ready to cut somebody with. No longer do you allow your hands, your body members, your mind to yield itself to those thoughts and those ways. And that's when you begin to be in church. Not just at church, but in church. They were first called Christians at Antioch.
Amen.
And I have to believe it was because the way they were carrying themselves. They were teaching and preaching it, but evidently they were also living it.
Yes, yes.
And it's one thing to talk about it, it's another thing to live it.
Yes,
yeah, 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 yeah. Yeah. We get up every Sunday morning and come out, put on Sunday clothes, carry our Bibles under our arm, and we think that makes us a Christian. But baby, it's what you do on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and all of that rest of the week that determines how much Christ you have in you.
Yes, yes.
They saw them in Antioch loving their enemies. They saw them treating people right. Oh, glory. Yeah, yeah, they were first called Christians because they were believing in Christ. They believed in Christ. They really believed in. They didn't just profess with their mouth, but they believed in their hearts that Jesus is the Christ, Son of the living God. They believed in their heart that God raised him from the dead.
Yes, yes.
And they lived in Antioch.
Baby, we can talk a good game. Can you walk the walk?
Amen.
Talk the talk, but can you walk the walk?
Amen. I'm just about through because I know some of y'all
come on now.
Might be mad.
Come on. It's all right. It's all right.
Come on.
That's a true fact anyhow.
See, because all day long I can believe that, say I believe that Jesus died and raised from the grave. Honey, do you really, really, really believe it? If you believe it,
yes,
it'll show. It'll show up.
Yeah.
If you tell your wife how much you love her, tell your husband how much you love him, tell your boo how much you love her every day. I love you, baby. I love you. I love you, baby. I love you. I love you, baby. I love you. You don't never bring no flowers home. I love you, baby. You don't open no doors. I love you, baby. You don't treat her kind and sweet, honey. She gonna look at you and it's just gonna become redundant. You mean, wah, 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 baby. Wah, 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 Charlie Brown. That's right. You, in other words, love is an action word. You, yeah, if you love me, show me you love me. Yeah, if you love me, let me know every now and then by the way you treat me, by the way you hold me, by the way you take me out. Let me know. If you love me, let me know you love me.
Yes.
Show me your love. If you love Jesus, we ought to be able to show him our love through the life we live.
Yes, yes.
How we treat our brothers and sisters.
Yes.
How we work for him.
Yes.
If you love the Lord, when things don't go right in church, you don't get mad, take your ball and go home.
Yeah. Come on now. Come on.
If you really love Christ, you weather the storm. Yeah. Paul will tell you, I love the Lord. I used to persecute the church, but now I've been transformed and changed.
Yes,
and I love God so much that I'll endure whatever I have to for the cause of Christ.
Yes, sir. Yes. Amen.
If I'm broke, I'm still going to serve.
Yes, sir.
If I got money, I'm still going to serve.
Yes.
If you like it or not, I'm still going to serve.
Yes.
Yes, because I know in whom I have believed. It's one thing to believe, but you got to know in who you believe.
Yes, sir.
Yes, I know Jesus for myself.
Say it. Yes.
So I don't know who I'm talking to today. But if you're here today, your character ought to identify whose side you.
Say it.
People shouldn't have to guess.
Well,
you shouldn't have to wear a cross on your lapel and carry a Bible on your arm for people to know that you're a soldier in the army of the Lord.
Yes, sir.
That's a difference in your walk. That's a difference in your talk. How you carry yourself. Difference in what you listen to, what you let come into your life. See, honey, you have to understand Satan attacks every day. We have to be on guard 24/7, 365 days a year. We have to study the Word of God. We need to be in Sunday school and Bible study. We need the Word of God. That's our weapon to fight this warfare. And as Christians, we ought to get in the Word and get the Word in us.
Yes.
Then we can share it with those that come into contact with us.
Yes.
It's first grade. second grade, third grade, cussing like soldiers. I hear him telling you, B, get off me. You don't know me. And then when we call the parents, well, they don't do this at home, no, because you'll smack them in the mouth. But I want to ask them, where you learn, where they learned it at? What am I saying? I'm talking to some parents in here. They learn from you. Mm-hmm. Talking to some grandparents in here, they learn from you. Honey, they can't learn them words and use them in a proper context unless they heard them before. They don't know enough grammar and English yet. And baby, they use them perfectly. They sure do. Ooh-wee. If you can't say amen this morning, say ouch. Amen. I like to believe they were called Christians because they were belonging to Christ. They were belonging to Christ. And I want to tell you today, you belong to Christ.
Yeah.
Because you have been bought with the price.
Yeah.
The precious blood of Jesus that was shed on Calvary's cross over 2,000 years ago paid your sin debt. And you are not your own anymore.
Right.
If you've truly been born again, I'm talking about born again folk.
Yeah.
And you know, there's some folk in church ain't been born again.
Amen.
Oh yeah, I'm talking to born again folk. We realize and recognize we are not our own. That we belong to Christ and we owe him everything.
Yes,
every waking moment we ought to live that God might get the glory out of our life. I'm sorry that it took me so long to learn this stuff for myself. But baby, we're a work in progress. But when you realize and recognize that you are not your own, you belong to Christ, when you realize that there's work for you to do, and then you start doing that work to the best of your ability, you're going to be criticized and ostracized on every hand, sometimes even in your family, on your job, in your personal relationship. But when you work for the Lord, there's something within you.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, the devil won't allow you to worry about what they're saying about you. Because I realize and recognize now, there's so many things about me, but only what I do for Christ will last. And when I have to stand before my Maker and give an account for the deeds that I've done, I want to give and say, well done.
Amen.
Good and faithful servant.
Yes.
You weren't faithful over everything, Terry. Mm-hmm. But the hell out.
Yes.
Yes. Oh, glory.
Yes.
Stop playing with the Lord, folks. Be real. Serve him with gladness.
Yeah.
Ask folk to do something at your job. All frowned up again. They're like going to ask you to give $100,000. No. Do what you can. That was the saying of my father-in-law. The lady Elder Fred going out. You do what you can, Doc. Why you can.
Yeah.
Sutherland used to say, I ain't working to be saved.
Yeah.
But I'm working because I am saved.
Yeah.
And that's the difference. There's a difference. Goodbye, 12th Street. Finally find you
well.
I'm just praying that. That somebody see Christ in you. And along the other names they call him, they just might stop and say, you know what? He or she is a Christian. I've watched them. And they live like Christ. They act like Christ. And that's what Christian is, being Christ-like.
Amen.
So to you today, understand this. Jesus paid it all.
Yes.
All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain.
Sin?
But he washed. He washed it.
Well.
White as snow. When did he do that? One dark Friday.
Well.
He went to a hill called Calvary.
Yes.
Not for anything that he had done. But he went out there for you, 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 and I.
compensation for sin in his blood. And Jesus shed his precious blood out on Calvary. He hung there from the sixth to the ninth hour just for you. And then he died. He died for you. But I'm so glad today. That's not how the story ends. Scripture says 3 days later, hallelujah, he rose again. And I'm so glad that they didn't leave Jesus in the grave, that God raised him from the dead. Because when he got up with all power in his hand, power to speak, and man would have to lay down and die. Power to speak, and man could live again. He had the power to reach down to save a wretch like shall rise first to meet him in heaven. Yes, sir. So if I'm dead,